Man. I wonder if that was Marvel Studios' actual response when Entertainment Weekly called them up for a photo for their upcoming summer movie preview issue. That's where this photo comes from. It's our first look at Yellowjacket, the big villain of the movie played by Corey Stoll, who I'm sure is just as unhappy to have his face covered up as poor Paul Rudd. And speaking of Paul Rudd, he's in this photo too! I would never have known it if the article that accompanied this photo hadn't said, Yellowjacket will fight Ant-Man as shown in this picture. And I was like, what now? So I looked at it really closely, and I did indeed spot Ant-Man, which, by the way, could be an interesting merchandising opportunity for the property, you know, like a bunch of children's books being like, you know, instead of Where's Waldo, where's Ant-Man? And they made it difficult for us here, because as you can see, they paused Ant-Man mid-leap in black over black. He's on the shoulder part of Yellowjacket's costume, and I would have been like, if I were the producer, I'd be like, well, let's just go a few frames forward where maybe he's over the yellow part a little bit more so he's more visible. And, you know, you never want the hero of your movie to be difficult to see. So we'll see how they handle that in the actual movie. But one of the interesting things that was revealed with this photo, besides the look of Yellowjacket, who, by the way, I think looks really cool, was that, you know, when you see them, you know, about to collide fists, you might think, that's ridiculous. Ant-Man, you're going down and you're going down fast. But they explained that's not actually the case because Ant-Man, when he gets smaller in size, he increases his density and his speed, which is something, you know, Edgar Wright talked about playing with the action sequences. So while I'm excited to see that play out, you know, this is one of those rare photos where you're like, yes, unpause it, please. I have such little faith in Peyton Reed's ability to deliver this material. And every time I see a photo from the Ant-Man film, particularly this one, because it reminds me so much of Scott Pilgrim, it just makes me a little sad inside because we won't get to see Edgar Wright's version of the property, which I think he was just a perfect match for and spent so much time developing. Now, obviously, a lot of his stuff will make it to the final product because that's Marvel property, and when he left, he had to leave all that behind. But of course, Marvel's been very eager to put their own stamp on it because they don't want everybody being like, Edgar Wright was right, as that one dude outside of Comic-Con last year did with his little picket sign. So, you know, Paul Rudd and Adam McKay rewrote this considerably, and I'm sure Peyton Reed has tried to put his Peyton Reed stamp on it, whatever that stamp might look like. I would think it would be, you know, low on ink, quite frankly. The point of this episode today is to discuss this reveal, this first look at Yellowjacket, and as I said, I like it a lot. One thing that's interesting, though, is the bug motif they have in this movie, and I put Ant-Man's photo up as well, so you can not only see his costume, but also to see how much it sucks in comparison to Yellowjacket's. I guess one is the wealthy guy, one's like the little snappy upstart from, you know, Hank Pym, and, you know, one's in a shower curtain, you know, in a shower doing tests, the other's in a high-tech lab. You know, the 1% versus the 99%. There are a bunch of ways you could go with this, but at the end of the day, it boils down to one guy's suit is much cooler than the others. But the bug motif is interesting because it plays a lot off of Spider-Man, which of course is now a partial, you know, Marvel commodity because they made that deal with Sony. Like when you see the stingers behind Yellowjacket, you know, on the one hand you're like, bees don't have that. I'd probably so frustrate Yellowjacket. I'd be like, bees don't have like movable like little things like that. That's more like a scorpion, so that your theme is messed up. But he'd be like, they look cool. And I'd be like, they do look cool. So I have to give you that. But the bug theme is so similar to Spider-Man and a lot of his villains that, you know, as the comic book movie universes begin, you know, expand and we see more superheroes entering the fray, I think they have to be really, really careful to make sure that they differentiate them enough so that the layman, you know, the mainstream moviegoer who doesn't read all these comics, isn't like, isn't that the other guy? And, you know, the other guy whose movie also wasn't so good, you know, et cetera, et cetera. But I do think it's really funny that Yellowjacket is working very hard with the theme. I love that he has the honeycomb pattern on his costume, which is cool. But I just think it's really funny that this tough business guy, you know, whoever Corey Stoll is playing, but, you know, he's the villain of the piece, where he's like, I have to have the bee motif. You got to put that on there. You're like, well, why don't you put some antenna on, too, if you're going to go that far? You know, I hope, you know, this is supposed to have comedic aspects to it, and I think that could be the one thing that really, really puts this movie over the top and saves it from the clutches of failure that it seems to be rocketing towards. But I love the light-up aspects of the costume. I love the way the eyes light up. I think that looks really cool. I love the stingers that they're lit up. You know, they talked about in the article that Yellowjacket has weapons on his suit, but Ant-Man does not, you know, except for his humor. You know, really, you know, you think about a humorous villain, I mean, a humorous hero, that really is also like Spider-Man too, right? Having to use his banter to offset the villain, catch him off guard. You know, you have a very similar situation where, you know, maybe Paul Rudd would have been a great choice for Peter Parker. Although, I have to say, when you consider the box office numbers here, Marvel's lowest performers have been, it's the lowest of the lowest, is the Incredible Hulk worldwide. Let me see, I have it written down here, 263.4 million. But, you know, technically, with the movies that they consider, you know, I think The Incredible Hulk is supposed to be considered canon, but where is Ed Norton, where is Betty Ross, etc., etc.? The lowest of the more official movies is Captain America the First Avenger with 370 million. These are worldwide numbers again. Now, as for Paul Rudd, the most successful movie that he's ever been in where he was a star was where he co-starred in Role Models, which made 92 million worldwide. So they really have to bring those, hopefully the numbers will, you know, err more on the side of the low Marvel movies than the high Paul Rudd movies. But I think this costume is cool. I think it screams Edgar Wright. I like the light-up aspects, but I think there's a little bit of a feeling of Spider-Man there. I'm very curious to see how this movie turns out. I really have a hard time. You know, we're starting to get also to the point where they bring in these heroes and they don't adapt them too much for live action. For instance, I think they made a lot of changes that worked really well so far in the MCU and even also in the Warner Brothers DC movies. But then when you start bringing characters like Vision and Ant-Man who can talk to ants, you start to wonder how far you can push, or pull, I guess in this case, the mainstream non-comic book reader into our world, right? Where they're, you know, it's like they weren't in here for a reason, and if you perhaps get too comic booky, they might be like, I'm out, this is why I don't read comics, they're silly. So I'm curious what you guys think of this. I think this is very promising for a movie that so far does not seem promising. So write your thoughts down below. We have a whole bunch of, you know, reveals to discuss today, and I hope you'll check out those as well, for instance, right now.